Episode 17, The Great Cultural Shift of the High Middle Ages. In this episode, we leave the sphere of political events in order to observe certain changes that were occurring on a much deeper level, in the sphere of culture and religion. Cultural change can be far-reaching and it can come about unperceived. The new can take form so gradually that its novelties are believed to have always been the case. I wish to draw attention to some crucial changes in religious temperament and outlook that gradually occurred from the 11th century onwards, and which came to fruition and took their definitive forms in the century from 1250 to 1350. Not only did these shifts or reinterpretations give medieval Christian society many of its most striking features, but they entailed a further divergence of Occidental Christianity away from the more conservative and traditional temperament of Greek-speaking Eastern Christianity. The Romans of the East, of Constantinople, as their power declined, clung ever more fervently to their ancient traditions, a form and tenor of Christianity which I believe has remained closer to its original Constantinian roots. The ways in which the European Occident altered and continued to grow away from its Eastern origins found expression most strikingly in the fields of religious activity and practice, as well as that of artistic expression. We should remember that art in such a society, in medieval society, had no separate status. Museums then were not the cathedrals of the day, as they are now. Actual cathedrals occupied that position at the center of the culture. Nor were successful artists revered as having special spiritual qualities. Actual priests, friars, and holy men occupied that social and symbolic position then. Art was a means to evoke the divine. Artists were skilled craftsmen who had the necessary techniques to do so. They shared with masons, bakers, and blacksmiths the mystery, mestiere in modern Italian, or the skill set of their trade. But they, unlike their peers, fashioned images of the supernatural world. The two great styles of this period, which we have been taught to call the Gothic and the Renaissance respectively, were not in opposition to one another. The Renaissance style did not chronologically succeed that of the Gothic, as thousands of art history books appear to suggest, nor did the Renaissance style oust and substitute itself in the place of the Gothic. In fact, the two styles, the Gothic and Renaissance, ran in parallel as two expressions of the same underlying impulses, with the Gothic having had a good head start of over a century on the Renaissance. Both had run their course at more or less the same time, by the late 1500s. The style that did oust the Gothic was not the Renaissance, but the Baroque. The Gothic and the Renaissance style, in fact, shared common roots in the shift in religious sentiment that occurred during the Central Middle Ages. And we will better understand and appreciate works in either style once we have grasped the underlying essentials of what that shift consisted of, and what the two styles shared in common. Among the major social changes that began in the 1000s and came to fruition in the late 1200s and 1300s was the germination and vigorous growth of the urban form of economic life. Today this is usually called capitalism, as if there were some other ism to which it was but one alternative. The actual historical alternative was local production for subsistence. In effect, the self-sufficient seigneurial manor or monastery with its estates, each of which constituted an inward-directed economic universe of its own. This had been the reality of economic life in the Occident since the destruction of the Mediterranean economy many centuries previously. The towns in general prospered, most benefiting from the positive feedback mechanism spurring their growth and inner complexity. The money economy spread ever more widely, replacing self-sufficiency and barter. Poor peasants and victims of seasonal hardship migrated to the teeming world within the walls of the nearest city. Prices tended to rise, social relations became more fluid than they had been for centuries. Some level of literacy and numeracy became prized skills within this new complex commercial setting. This too is the setting where religious innovation and sometimes rebellion flourished as never before. The Cathars in southern France and northern Italy had already been mentioned, but there were numerous other effervescent movements, such as the Waldensteins or Vaudois in the margins of the Lower Alps, the Umiliati and Pauvres de Lyon, to name but a few. The church itself may have contributed to these innovations and rejections. In its centuries-long struggle with the Western emperors, from the 1070s to the 1260s, strong arguments have been made against the ideology of a God-anointed sacral kingship. In a Christian tradition stretching back to Constantine and his imperial successors, and handed down to Charlemagne and to the heirs of his prestige, the Old Testament ideal of King David, God's sword and defender of the church, had prevailed. The papacy, the Roman Curia, and their network of ecclesiastical proponents instead brought into the foreground the messages found in the New Testament of the centrality and primacy of the ministry of Christ and of his designation of a successor in the Apostle Peter, and so to the bishops of Rome, etc. A key quote from the Vulgate New Testament of St. Jerome was a Latin and indeed a Greek pun: Tu es Petrus et super hanc Petram edificabo ecclesiam meam. You are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. Petrus, the name, means rock in Latin. The emphasis on the New Testament, though it in no way signaled a lessening of belief in the integrity of the two and from our perspective vastly heterogeneous halves of the Bible, nevertheless brought with it a whole movement of religious concentration and contemplation on the New Testament's messages. The success of heretical movements, their proselytizing effectiveness, had spurred Orthodox clerics to redouble their efforts to do what they regarded anyway as their duty, to bring home to the ordinary people, now more than ever concentrated in towns, the lesson and the force of the divine story. In a society where literacy was a rarity, and which was based on a compendious set of sacred writings, new ways were sought to communicate that which the monks and friars had read and contemplated. True to its Mediterranean cultural traditions, where the modalities of expression had been monumental architecture, representation of the human and the divine, and communicative rhetoric and poetry, the medieval church reached for these also as the primary means in order to show, explain, and enact the highlights of the Christian narrative of redemption. We have seen how the sculpted and painted tympani of the great Romanesque cathedrals had long given object lessons in the nature of the divine cosmos, of the fall of Adam, the last judgment, heaven and hell, in order to teach religious dread and the necessity of repentance. These religious object lessons in stone underwent a gradual transformation in the course of the 1100s and early 1200s. The initial center of that change was in the Île-de-France, the Seine Valley and heartland of the Capetian dynastic power. The initial form it took was architectural. Between 1137 and 1144, Abbot Suger carried through an almost complete rebuilding of the old Carolingian fabric of the church of Saint-Denis, just north of Paris. This was the sacral center of the Capetian dynasty, the sepulchre of its ancestors, and its link to the legitimacy provided by the church and monastery founded by Dagobert I in the 660s AD, and which had been the chief prop and locus of the West Frankish Carolingians. Even at this date, Suger wished to emulate the design he had seen in Rome of the Arch of Constantine beside the Colosseum, with its large central portal flanked by two lesser ones. But in complete contrast to the Roman triumphal arch, with its ground-crushing solidity, Suger wished to push the fabric of his basilica upwards. To achieve this, his master masons proposed the croisée d'ogive, or groin arch, which channeled the weight stresses of the structure down to four symmetrical arched segments and thence down the supporting piers. These piers could be of immense height, and the groin arch could rise much higher still, heavenward in fact. As a side effect, this structural innovation did away with the need to rest the structure on continuous, thick, supporting walls, as the Roman basilica had always done. These spaces between the piers could be filled in with thin screen walls, and their upper portions could be replaced with nothing more solid than a leaded filigree of stained glass, thereby allowing colored light to flood the inner space. We have adopted the pedantic insult against this style, which was coined in the 1550s, 4 centuries after its appearance, by Giorgio Vasari, who called it lo stilo tedesco, the German style. In fact, in its own time, the new style was known as the opus francigenum, work in the French style, revealing the Italian writer's carelessly polemical motive in labeling it barbarous. This vocabulary was sharpened further by deploying the term gotico, or Gothic, by which Vasari meant the style of the Goths, or rather Visigoths, who were believed to have destroyed Rome in 410 AD. It is now impossible to avoid using this insult term Gothic to refer to this most beautiful and technically sublime stylistic breakthrough, one which so characterizes our European cultural heritage. The so-called Gothic became, remarkably quickly, the characteristic style of the Latin Occident. It was spread by the Benedictines and by the new Dominican and Franciscan orders, as well as by the competitive emulation of kings, of bishops, and of the burgomasters of the rapidly growing cities. The physical pattern of the spread of the Gothic style effectively marks the geographical limits of European society and culture, even today. Every town and city with a major Gothic or older church at its heart was without doubt for centuries an organic component within the original European civilization. Saint-Denis, mentioned above, suffered grievous physical damage at the hands of zealots at the height of the French Revolution during the 1790s. So despite restoration in the 19th century, its Gothic splendor is seriously diminished. In fact, today the Basilica of Saint-Denis sits isolated and largely ignored at the heart of one of Paris's largest arrondissements and lies very much off the cultural tourist trail. A far better idea of the glory of this style can be seen in the Cathedral of Chartres, 80 kilometers southwest of Paris, built in stages between 1134 and 1260. What is particularly telling about these structures, apart from their fabric and form, is their ornamentation. It is a standard procedure among art historians of the period to follow the sequence of sculptures on the initial western portal, the Porte Royale of Chartres, of about 1150, and then to follow that with those of the southern and northern portals between 1205 and 1210. On the earlier western portal, the figures follow the Romanesque convention of being conceived as part of the architectural form, elongated to fit the thin columns they stand out from. Nevertheless, this is sculpture almost in the round, rendering highly individualized personalities. And there also is Maria with the child Jesus, in the posture of maestà, or majesty. The Virgin is positioned in a triumphal, central setting over the right-hand door, a figure of real power. Below her are, as if on stage, two acted-out scenes from her life, the presentation in the temple and the Dormition. Christ in majesty occupies the tympanum over the central door. A generation later, in the early 1200s, another team of masons sculpted an altogether different concept of sacredness on the north and south portals of this same cathedral. Here we have sculpture in the round. Here is human flesh and human feeling rendered in stone. What has happened in between? In this scene, the Old Testament prophet Daniel is adjacent, in divine space, to the New Testament visitation of Saint Elizabeth to the Virgin Mary. The two women form a dynamic unity. They give attention to one another. Their expressions communicate the gravity of the news they exchange, that both are with child, Elizabeth with John the Baptist, Mary with Jesus. The human tenderness of the scene is striking. The same theme of the visitation is treated again on the west porch of the Cathedral of Reims, or Reims, about 1225, and is taken to unexampled heights. Here is a vision of human dignity rendered with a mastery and feeling that brings it to the level of the sculptures of the great moments of classical antiquity, giving the group an Olympian substantiality, voluminousness, grace, and serenity. And yet we know immediately, at looking at it, that this is Christian art, medieval art. What was going on in the culture that such a sudden leap forward to a new aesthetic was made possible? These changes were occurring at the height of the Crusades. In 1112, the great victory of Las Navas de Tolosa in southern Iberia had been won by Christendom against the Saracens. The crusade against the Cathars in the county of Toulouse was in full swing. In Aquitaine, Saint Dominic was founding the Order of Preachers with papal sanction, the Dominicans, 1216. And in northern Italy, Saint Francis likewise was leading a new charismatic movement of begging and preaching fratres, or brothers, the Franciscans, receiving papal approval for his order in 1209. Certainly, Occidental Christendom was in a ferment of conflict, creativity, and growth during these opening decades of the 1200s. The Church desired to engage the people ever more intimately in the realities, as it conceived them, of the faith. This was made more urgent in response to the new populations of the cities, and partly as a consequence to combat the remarkable success that heretical movements were having among these town dwellers in some regions. And the populace itself experienced waves of collective religious fervor. Large groups of young men would throw up everything and go off on crusade, many never to return. In one of the great building phases of Chartres Cathedral, men and women of the locality, of all social orders, high and low, were seized with such devotional enthusiasm that they unharnessed the oxen and themselves pulled uphill the wagons laden with stones to the cathedral building site, singing hymns. The case has been made, by Erwin Panofsky for one, that it was the intellectual absorption of the works of Aristotle in the universities, especially the Aristotelian doctrine of the ontology of the soul, that caused the humanizing aesthetic revolution that we know as the Gothic to occur. Scholasticism, the fusion of the Christian belief structure with the Aristotelian categories and logic, was indeed developing during the 1200s into the mainstream intellectual and educational movement of the Occident, and was to profoundly shape medieval European society. But I find it difficult to believe that high and complex philosophical theory could have been the only or even the main influence that triggered this artistic and indeed moral breakthrough. I think the causes lay deeper and were more widespread. They were embedded in the religious texture of the times. One contributing factor, at least, I believe, was the new prominence given to sacral drama during this period. Theatrical performance, by its very nature, leaves almost no trace, whereas the massive stone edifices of Chartres, Notre-Dame de Paris, and Reims, etc., certainly do. But this should not blind us to the realities of the time. Preaching from the pulpit was reflected in the sculpted scenes on the cathedral exteriors. Paintings and wood carvings used the same themes as did the sculptors, and the dramatization of the liturgy and of the preached message was a natural development. Ancient Athenian tragedy had emerged, we know, within the context of a highly charged communal religious festival, the Dionysia. The roots of the European dramatic tradition were religious. After the political fragmentation of the Occident, the ancient theatrical tradition had continued, at least sporadically, as an aspect of courtly life. A substantial literature now exists concerning medieval theatre. The further back one goes, however, the scarcer become the sources. But it is clear, as Alessandro d'Ancona has written, Origini del Teatro in Italia, that in the 1200s, across the heartlands of Latin Christendom, a more pronounced and elaborate form of liturgical drama developed. In contrast to informal popular theatre outside on the streets, this drama had its origins inside the church, at the altar. The Latin Church's Mass always had been a ritual performance. Key symbolic moments in the narrative of Jesus' life, reduced to ritual, were commemorated by the priest through reenactment. As the priesthood increasingly became a caste apart, mediating directly with heaven and separate from the general populace, so too did the need arise for a drawing in of the congregation to what was being performed behind the screen at the altar. That need was most keenly felt by the friars of the new and rapidly growing mendicant orders, the Franciscans and the Dominicans. In the late 1200s, a leading Franciscan, Jacopone da Todi, is noted for having actively approved and promoted the use of theatrical reenactments to communicate the religious message to the people. From somewhat later centuries, the 1400s and 1500s, have come down to us the documentary evidence for what were, in fact, far more archaic practices, the ordinarii, or ordinaries, of this or that church. One from Parma in the 1200s, the Ordinarium Ecclesiae Parmensis, was performed at the High Feast of Easter with the express purpose of ad inducendum populum ad contritionem, to induce the population to contrition and to confirm the same in devotion to the Virgin Mary. The performance took place in the church when an angel descended, or was lowered, from a height down to the pulpit, where was represented the Blessed Virgin, to whom the angel announced that she was to become the Mother of God, etc. A rare survival of this ancient form of theatre can still be witnessed in August each year in the Basilica of Santa Maria de Elche in the province of Valencia in Spain, where just such an angelic descent is the high point of the drama. In all cases, the words of the passage of the gospel were encountered through singing. Song came before theatrical dialogue. We have evidence of dialogue exchanges at the high points of the action, framed about with solo or choric incantation. The music we are listening to is an elaborate survival, complete with musical notation, of a sung liturgical drama dating from between 1270 and 1297, the Laudario di Cortona. This is a mixture of formal church pieces in Latin, such as Ave Maria Gloriosa, and songs in the vernacular of that region, such as Vergine Doncella Dam Dio Amata, Damsel Virgin Beloved of God. Such sung enactments were a seamless and natural extension of the age-old impulse on great festivals to bring the ritual out of the church and into the life of the city through the streets. Great processions with the image of the Virgin or the saint carried aloft by pallbearers were integral to the communal and religious life of medieval communities for centuries. A practice dating back to Roman times, which still flourishes in some places today. The performance of individual scenes at way stations in such processions, intended for the edification of the throng of people lining the streets, saw the emergence of liturgical drama into the public spaces. Saint Francis encouraged with his special authority the emerging practice of enacting the nativity scene, the glory of God's incarnation in the poor setting of a stable, with the devoted parents on either side of the baby Jesus in a manger, mangeoire, from manger, to eat. Today we still use figurines to recreate this enactment so beloved of the Middle Ages, I suspect exactly as it was once performed. Such dramatization, such reenactment, I believe, injected a new immediacy into the Christian story. This immediacy derived its emotional force from bringing the cosmic narrative down to a human level. Injected into the Christian story was a human appeal, a personal identification with the events being represented. Wonder, empathy, reverence, all were stimulated in the spectators. But of course, the central event of the Evangelion of the Gospels was the climactic sequence known as the Passion. From the 1000s onwards, then, I think, we can observe a gradual shift occurring in Occidental Christianity. The majesty and serenity of the divinity gradually became softened. His distance from the believer became foreshortened. In effect, this foreshortening of perspective amounted to a rearrangement of the Trinity. A contemplation of the nature of the sacrifice of Jesus, believed to have been necessary to redeem Christians from sin, had yielded a heightened consciousness of his humanity, his having taken human form, and what this implied. There was a zooming in of focus on the pathos of the divine being, living and suffering as a man. Christ became vulnerable in ways that had not been considered before. The suffering, the passio of Christ, the God-man, became the central concern of devotion. Priests, monks, and friars meditated until they reached transports of compassion, of suffering with the crucified Christ. Their spiritual exercises were aimed at working up the intensity of this feeling of co-suffering. And this was the burden of the preaching of the mendicant friars to the ordinary people. Compassion, an emotional state of plangent pity, was whipped up with every technique available from rhetorical training and the speaker's skill. In 1270, Cimabue painted a wooden crucifixion for the Dominican church at Arezzo in Tuscany. The Dominican specifically asked him to model his crucifixion on the work of Giunta Pisano, which hung at their chief church at Bologna, where the bones of St. Dominic himself were held as relics. This crucifixion was of a new type, that of the Christus Patiens, the suffering Christ. Cimabue rendered the body of Jesus contorted, twisted, and jutting out from the plane of the cross, in a posture at once elegant and expressive of extreme agony. God the Father is above, while Maria and St. John are to the left and right. And by the way, Eastern Orthodoxy had always shied away from making carved representations of Christ and other semi-divinities. This was to keep within the letter of the stricture against, quote, graven, or that is, carved images, unquote, contained in the monotheistic Old Testament. Instead, painted two-dimensional representations were allowed, marking a fundamental difference between the religious art of Constantinople and that of the Latin Occident. Paradoxically, then, for this reason, European art remained more faithful to the traditions of ancient Hellenism than did the Greek-speaking Christianity of the Eastern Mediterranean, the homeland of that Hellenism. Cimabue is the artist whom Vasari says first broke away from what he saw as the stiff and artificial style of the Greeks, the style of the icons. The effect is dramatic. The agony of the crucifixion is dramatized as never before. The symbol of the cross loses some of its ancient, totemic, and triumphal presence, and becomes instead a theme of the real and very human suffering of Christ as a man. God the Father, in a sense, recedes as a figure. His placidity and authority become firmly upstaged, I use the theatrical term deliberately, by the drama happening right in front of the audience. Weep, we are exhorted, for Christ is suffering for your sins. Western Christianity was becoming that religion des Mitleids, religion of pity, that Nietzsche was to so deride it for in the late 19th century. The English word pity comes from the Latin term pietas, which means piousness, from pius. The pagan Aeneas, Virgil tells us, was pious. Piety in its old sense, reverent respect for the divine and towards one's parents, was melding into a wider meaning. That respect was becoming heated. It was becoming compassion, mitleid, suffering with. The word simultaneously changed its meaning and forked into piety and pity. The Italian for pity is pietà. Many of us know this from Michelangelo's famous marble sculpture, La Pietà, showing the Virgin Maria holding the dead body of Jesus on her lap. Michelangelo was able to conceive of such a form in 1499, because by then the idea and the feeling had already been a fully worked out trope of Christian devotional art, already for 250 years. What I point to here is a shift in religious sensibility and perception, occurring roughly between 1150 and 1300, which laid the basis for certain characteristics of Western culture, which live on in our minds and hearts to this day, albeit under largely secularized guises. The penchant for compassion that developed within Western culture took centuries to become deeply rooted. The cruelty with which we reproach the Middle Ages shows precisely how things were before and during the prolonged period of the seeding and rooting of compassion as a socialized assumption. Indeed, it may be that the growth of the formal persecution of religious and social deviants, noticeable at that time, can be directly linked to the raised emotional temperature concerning religious solidarity. Perceived outrage of the collective sense of decency could provoke pitiless communal wrath against the miscreant. The path leading to our modalities of compassion still stretched very far into the future, but without that initial shift in the religious sphere, our sense of what it is decent to feel would never have taken the form it has. The figure of the Virgin is the second great element in the before-mentioned rearrangement of the Trinity. There is no doubt that Maria, Mother of God, held a very sacred place in the religious imagination of ancient Roman Christianity. The Eastern Constantinopolitan tradition elevated her as Theotokos, the God-bearer, building churches dedicated to her solely. And on the unofficial level, in keeping with the instincts of Mediterranean religion, Maria had always been venerated by ordinary people. Occidental Latin Christianity, however, began from the 1100s onwards to elevate her to an even more prominent position and to revere her with a particular concentration. And in the West, this change received full endorsement and encouragement from the highest authorities in the Church. This enthusiasm gathered force, such that by the mid-1200s, Maria was positioned at the focal point of Christian devotion. Reformation preachers would, 250 years later, fulminate against this as Mariolatry, as idolatry in the old monotheistic sense, which had little or no foundation in the Old or New Testaments, and they were quite right. But her rise can be understood as part and parcel of the injection of a more vivid and immediately felt humanity into the key images of the Christian story. The figure of the Christus patiens, Christ suffering, effectively called Maria to come much closer into the center of the scene. She is the Mater Dolorosa, the mother in pain, standing or kneeling at the foot of the cross. The new artistic mise en scène in which she took a central role were the deposition and the lamentation. In 1305, Giotto painted the beautiful Scorvegni Chapel at Padova. It contains crucifixion and lamentation scenes which supremely express the new tenor of religious feeling. So fascinating did the figure of Maria appear that she became, in effect but not in theology, another person of the Trinity. Indeed, she is placed so close to Jesus that often the dove of the Paraclete, the Holy Spirit, is depicted radiating above her head. Saint Dominic, founder of the Dominican order, had a conversion dream in which the Virgin appeared to him and, legend has it, presented him with the beads of the rosary, the rosaria, garland of roses. This was and is a round of prayer formulae told off on the beads. The opening part of the Ave Maria, a glorification, is very old, attested from the 300s AD onwards. The second part, however, was added in the period we are speaking of, almost 1,000 years later. This introduces a different element. It is an imprecation. It is asking for something. It is asking the Mother of God to pray for us sinners, and to do so urgently, now, and above all, at the hour of death, when judgment awaits. She is Mediatrix Noster, the mediator and advocate of our importuning requests to her Son, whom popular belief assumed would be well disposed to her wishes. Here was another way to approach God, a more approachable object and focus for the relief of anxiety. The original, rather abstract, conception of the Trinity, of Father, Son, and Spirit, all the same and each different, was retained in its full sense in theology. But in representational imagery, heaven, the locus of the Godhead, was presented ever more clearly as a set of relationships within a family, between a son and his mother. The Paraclete, or Spirit, had always been obscure. Gradually, over the coming centuries, the loser in the new humanized iconography of Western Christianity was to be God the Father. It is as if the culture needed such a figure as Maria at the center of its reverence and aspirations. In the masculine-oriented writings concerning the life of Jesus from the first century AD, the Gospels, she is essentially a peripheral figure, a bystander. By the 1200s, she is a superstar, Stella Maris. The stiff, distant, and severe mother figure of the art of previous centuries is displaced from the 1200s onwards by representations of the Virgin as the closest and most gentle personage in the heavens, by the suffering Mater Dolorosa, to be sure, but also by that unique European cultural theme as La Madonna. We are all familiar, perhaps too familiar, with this image. We should be aware that the Virgin Mother and Child Jesus had not always been so lovingly imagined. And I cannot find in the art or artifacts of any other historical culture such a loving concentration upon this one image in its endless variety. The long-term implications of this breakthrough of the European imagination, which came to full bloom between 1250 and 1350, were to be immense, and were so profound that they must remain incalculable. I would term this change as a celestial emancipation of womankind, the pinnacle of the sacred, which had been a masculine space since the origins of Christianity, had become irrevocably feminized. And I am persuaded that the value and status of women in Western culture, our sensibility as to what is right and decent behavior between men and women, after many centuries of subsequent development, would have turned out very differently had it not been for the decisive symbolic elevation of the figure of Maria to the very center of religious focus in European culture that occurred deep in the Middle Ages. Another great influence in this process was the feminizing effect of the courtly culture of northern and southern France. A prayer poem written by the above-mentioned Franciscan, Jacopone da Todi, one of the famous Laudi, begins with the lines, O Señor, per cortesia, maname la malsania. O Lord, for courtesy's sake, send me ill health. That phrase, per cortesia, is revealing, and was, at the time, highly resonant. One source of the Gothic culture was the school of secular music poetry of the south of France, the Pays d'Oc, the literature and music of the troubards, or trouvères, or troubadours, as we call them, treated previously in episode 12. The practitioners of this art of sung poetry were members of the nobility, often of the highest rank. Alongside this southern culture and interwoven with it was the romantic culture of northern France. I say romantic because at its heart were the romance tales, like the Roman de la Rose, written between 1230 and 1275, the cycle of the King Arthur legends by Chrétien de Troyes, late 1100s, and the work of Thomas d'Angleterre, Tristan et Isolde, Tristan and Isolde, about 1170. Romance as a genre term comes from the titles of these works, such as Le Roman d'Alexandre, Le Roman de Troyes, etc., indicating that they were written or recited in the vernacular Romangue or Roman, the Roman tongue, that is, in Old French. This is where our modern terms romance and romantic derive from. Key stylistic and moral aspects of this hugely popular and long-lasting genre were the Christianized ideals of the mounted warrior, the armed man on a horse, his cheval, whence chevalerie or chivalry, and the demeanor of this errant knight towards his noble lady, termed courtoisie, an attitude of restraint, devotion, tenderness, and self-effacing generosity. In modern English, it survives as courtesy. Courtoisie or cortesia meant, above all, a gentle, respectful, if sometimes ardent, attitude towards women of the court. The term gentilhomme or gentiluomo, a gentleman, as a moral quality associated with social standing, arose within this courtly culture. It meant a man who was no longer a mere brutish warrior, with crude manners and rough behavior. As Norbert Elias reports, gradually it became less and less morally or socially acceptable that some half-literate rural knight in his isolated castle strike his wife in anger. Among the nobility, the elaborate code of courtoisie came to overlay the codes of honor due to a woman on account of her male relative's social status, as gentlemanliness displaced unmediated manliness. A man of noble standing was now expected not only to be an excellent horseman, swordsman, and a courageous warrior, but also to be a competent dancer, conversationalist, and to have good table manners. The figure of the virtuous warrior central to courtly romance literature was what we call in English an errant knight, a wandering chevalier. By the way, in all the Latin languages of Europe, the word for knight is a variant of the word for a horseman, chevalier, cavalier, cavaliero. In German it is a Ritter, rider. But English has the peculiarly archaic term knight from Knecht, German for a lad or young man in service to a lord. While his lady is immobile and inaccessible, the chevalier errant, the wandering knight, must pursue his quest, encountering strange and dangerous opponents in outlandish places. It was in the context of the errant knight that Occidental Christianity in this period imagined its way unconsciously towards the reorganization of heaven and hell. Over the course of the 1100s and 1200s, the idea of purgatory took hold. Each believing individual, after death, would perhaps enter into heaven. The alternative to heaven was a version of that place which the ancient Mediterranean had always believed in, Hades, where souls wandered in a kind of doleful desolation. Hades merged with certain strands in the Judaic tradition to become, quite early, hell. The Greek-speaking church still refers to hell as Hades in some of its writings. The Christian hell, though, was a more energetic place than the classical Hades, with active torment carried out by daimoni, demons, as everyone living in an ancient city would have seen the models of in the arena, when before the games began, condemned criminals were cruelly executed in front of the entire populace. This afterlife of the human soul, of the most extreme imaginable opposites of heaven and hell, became the stock explanation of the individual's place in the cosmos. Of course, these stark and alarming alternatives facing one immediately after one's death were a matter of grave anxiety for Christians in proportion to their powers of imagination. But from the mid-1100s, stories began to emanate from distant Ireland of errant Christian knights, Owen, that is, Ioannis or John, or Tnugdal, who had either had a dream of hell or had entered the mouth of hell and there been beset by demons. Through the purity of their Christian faith, they had been saved from the clutches of the demons and were restored to life. These tales were brought back by pilgrims from Norman England who had visited the ancient site of St. Patrick's Purgatory on the island of Loch Derg, County Donegal, reputed to be near one of the mouths of hell. These tales were written down and became literary successes on a major scale, melding with other religio-chivalric themes current at the time. Known as the Visio Tnugdali and the Tractatus de Purgatorio Sancti Patrizii, which was translated into Norman French by none other than Marie de France, these were copied many times and disseminated across Europe. They provided the theme of the journey into the afterlife, one which had its precedents and perhaps its models in Homer and in Virgil, and so fitted neatly into the oldest traditions of European literature. The theme fitted in, too, with the needs of millions of people, tormented by the fear of hell and unsure of their admission into heaven. It fitted in with the, by then, very ancient Christian belief, shared with Greek Christianity, that some form of purgation or cleansing would necessarily occur for souls awaiting entry into heaven. But by the late 1100s, this state of being purged was being conceived of as a location, sharing the topography within the same scheme of heaven and hell as physical places. The equally ancient Christian prayers for the welfare of the dead fed into this concept and powerfully reinforced it. If one's beloved departed family and friends had indeed been sinners, then it was a natural leap of the imagination to see them in the process of expiation and purgation. They were all in the purgatorium, and one could pray for them to lessen their torments and speed their release into heaven. One prayed, one offered, one performed acts of love or good deeds, all with the fervent hope of helping one's loved ones, and perhaps of storing up similar remission for oneself, for when the time came. That the stark options of the two locations in the afterlife should be expanded to include a third was, I think, very much a humane development, and a partial release for the whole of Christian culture from the drastic ultimatum posed by the earlier scheme. It was a humanization of the divine cosmos, with its strict and appalling justice. In about 1270, the Dominican theologian from southern Italy working at Paris, Tommaso d'Aquino, St. Thomas Aquinas, was formulating the Purgatorium into his great Summa Theologica. Popular religious inventiveness was subsumed into high culture, in literature, by tales such as that of the Tractatus de Purgatorio Sancti Patrizii, and into the most intellectually comprehensive systematization of Christian theology ever written, the Summa Theologica. From 1308 until his death, Dante Alighieri, a political exile from his native Florence, wrote the three great books of La Commedia, known in English as the Divine Comedy. The first book is, of course, L'Inferno, the Italian word for hell. Saint Ambrosius used the term infernus in Latin in the late 300s AD. This place had nine circles, each more hellish in its torments, each designated for a specific gradation of sin.
Nel mezzo del cammin di nostra vita mi ritrovai per una selva oscura che la diritta via era smarrita. Ai quanto a dir qual era e cosa dura esta selva selvaggia e aspra e forte che nel pensier rinnova la paura.
The second part of the book, though, is the Il Purgatorio, with its eight stages of purification, directed to its optimistic exit point towards Il Paradiso, heaven. Canterò di quel secondo regno dove l'umano spirito si purga e di salire al ciel diventa degno. I will sing of this second kingdom, where the human spirit purges itself, and having become worthy, rises to heaven. The emergence of belief in the Purgatorium was a radical change. In the following centuries, the Purgatorium was to facilitate the growth of practices which came to be seen as abuses, and in 1517, became the issue which triggered the Reformation. The conventional narrative of European civilization centers on a proposed breach said to have occurred between two irreconcilable epochs, the medieval and the modern. This breach and rejection of the past is located in this narrative at the Renaissance. We will address this proposition directly in a subsequent episode. But here we have seen part of an alternate view, that a religious, moral, and artistic metamorphosis occurred within Latin Christian civilization, the West, which, though unnoticed as such by people at the time, nevertheless, in the perspective of history, can be understood as a shift in the sensibility and values of the civilization, which was of major significance. It was a religious, moral, and stylistic revolution, which was to have a highly contentious future, and would eventually trigger a fundamental revolt or counter-revolution against its explicit religious features. But the moral shift was permanent. The two and more centuries of confessional civil war that seized Europe between about 1500 and 1700 did not touch the new moral sensibility of the High Middle Ages. Indeed, the Reformation only served to concentrate the new values and feelings into a purified stream, stripped of their religious and, for a time, their artistic aspects. However, in the following episodes, we must first follow the historical evolution of the civilization over two more centuries, to the outbreak of that shattering religious revolt.